Good morning. Welcome to Hopewell Missionary Baptist Church Worship Service. We are located at 3285 Peach Orchard Road in Dazzle, South Carolina, near Shaw Air Force Base. Should this be your first time joining for worship, we extend a very special welcome to you. Please follow, like, and share as we celebrate, model, worship, and proclaim the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, thank you for joining.
Good morning. We have come into the house to worship him, Christ the Lord. And we come to give him praises. We come to sing praises. We come to pray. We come to lift up his name. And that's why we're here. We need to forget about ourselves and concentrate on him and worship him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come this morning lifting up your name and thanking you, Lord God, for this great opportunity. This opportunity to come out and worship you because you've been so good to us. Oh, Lord, you've blessed us so. And we thank you, Lord God, for the abundance of blessings that you bestowed upon us. We thank you for all the offerings that come into this house, for the upbuilding of the kingdom on this side, to touch lives far beyond these four walls, to change lives far beyond these four walls. Lord, we just thank all those that give, all those that want to give, and Lord, we just pray and that you will keep and bless them, Lord. And Lord, all these blessings we receive, Lord God, we pray that you will bless them also, that they can continue to grow, and that so some lives will be changed through them. We give you all praises, God, and thank you for this day of praising you. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Just say,
I'll say yes.
soul say yes. Will your spirit still say yes? Now will your heart and soul say yes? Say yes.
Bless you, God. Bless you, God. Bless you, Jesus. Bless your name, God. Bless your name, Jesus. Bless your name, God. Thank you, God. Bless your name, Jesus. Thank you, God. Bless your name, Jesus.
Come on and give the Lord a hand. Give the Lord a glory. Give him a praise. My soul, my soul. My soul says yes. From the bottom of my heart to the depths of my soul, I say yes, Lord, to your will and to your way. Thank you, choir. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for joining in. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy of hearing us say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, to your will and to your way. Everything moves by your power, Lord. And so we humble ourselves under your mighty hand, and we say yes. Yes to your love. Yes to your will. Yes to your way. Yes to your presence. Yes to your peace that passes all understanding. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. It's so good to be in this place of worship on this day that the Lord has given to us. And we just bless his name for the many blessings he has bestowed upon us and the things that he is still doing, that we might continue to weather the storm and walk by faith and not by sight. So greetings to all of you here in the sanctuary, those of you on Zoom, Facebook Live, YouTube, or whatever the medium may be that you connected to us on. We greet you in the marvelous name of our Lord and Savior, the Christ. It is good to be in this place, and we just thank him for his loving kindness and his tender mercies. And may his blessings continue to rain upon you, strengthen you on every side, and allow you to know that he is still on the throne, and there's none that can remove him from his place of residence. Church ought to say amen. 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 To the Lord be praised. Thanks to all the HBC church members for all the calls, texts, and prayers you did for me during my recent hospital stay. My heart was made happy knowing you love and care for me. Deaconess Mary Blanding, wanted to amen. To the Lord we pray. To the Lord. And to give the Lord a hallelujah praise because she is with us today. And she is of age, she can continue to sing and speak for herself. Praise the Lord. And so we thank the Lord for it. We would like to congratulate Navelle Boyd and Josiah Hilton and their mother, Tiara Hilton, and Sanaya Bolden Hilton in receiving a $6,000 scholarship for each child from the South Carolina School Choice Alliance. The ESA scholarship is for the use of school tuition and fees, tutoring, textbook, curriculum, instructional material, computer hardware, and other qualified educational material. Again, congratulations to Navelle and Josiah and their parents. And I wanted to make that announcement also. Amen. Amen. Wanted also to make there are things that are available to our young people. In addition to what we as the church are able to do, and we want you to be aware of these opportunities. I want to say this to all guardians, to all parents, that there are opportunities, and when those announcements come our way, we like to try to make sure that we share them with you so you can be in the know. And if you have a young child, or if you have one even in college, and you are unaware of some of the opportunities that they have, the financial opportunities, we want to try to make sure that we relate them to you. So congratulations to the Hilton family, and there are many, many more that can also benefit from some of these gifts. Amen. The other thing I want to encourage the parents for is as you receive the scholarship, work hard to use them wisely for your children. Use them wisely. They only have one time to grow up. And so if there's one thing we want to do, we want to religiously educate them, and then we certainly want to make sure that they receive a secular education that they can continue to matriculate through life. So we are here for you, and we thank the Lord for all he is doing, and yet more importantly, what he will continue to do. To the Hopewell family, we thank you for your many gifts, and we thank you for your continued support, your financial support, and your prayers as we continue to unite together. You hear me say this, and I must continue to say it. We are the body of Christ. We are spiritual blocks that makes up one body, and that body is the body of Christ. And when we join together as one for the glory of God, then there is strength. And where there is strength, it is because we unify ourselves together and subject ourselves to the Lord's will. So we thank the Lord for you. And those of you who may be visiting with us today, you may not care to stand, but we want you to know that you're welcome. Our welcome latches of cordiality on the outside of the door. And anytime you come to Hopewell, we want you to know that you're welcome. And if you are on one of the medium today and you are visiting with us, may the Lord's blessing be upon you. And you can always email us and allow us to know that you are watching. And also, if there's some information that we can relay to you, we will be more than happy to do that also. Amen. To the Lord be praised. And I believe that in him, that is in our Christ, the best is still yet to come as we trust him and not lean to our own understanding. Our scripture lesson is coming out of the book of John, chapter number 5. One verse I'm going to read, we'll look at a few other, but one verse, and that's verse number 24 out of the book of John, chapter number 24. Most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Repetitiously, good teacher. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. And the people of God said, amen, amen.
Good morning, saints.
Good morning, brother.
Did you know that this is a day that the Lord made?
Absolutely.
And we shall be glad in it. And we do give thanks for all that he does, because we know his mercies endures forever and through all generations. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we come to you under no strength of our own. And before we can say anything, we just say thank you, Lord, for what you've already done. We pray right now that you continue to walk with us through our ups and our downs. And we give you honor and praise. We thank you, Lord, for the thing that you continue to do in our lives. For everything might not be as pleasant as we would have them or like them to be. But rest assured, we know that you are there with us. And we thank you. We pray right now for those who are going through tribulation, pain, suffering, things that we might not know of. But we know, Heavenly Father, you are right there with them, with every step and every breath that we take. And we say thank you. Thank you, Lord. We pray for those who might be lying on a bed of affliction, suffering through unknown pain. But, oh Lord, we know just one touch from you can make us whole. We pray for our children's children. We pray for our moms and dads, sisters, brothers, uncles, aunts. We pray for all of your people, oh Heavenly Father. And we just ask you right now that you continue to hold us in the hollow of your hand. Protect us all from whatever hurt, harm, or danger might come our way. And we thank you. For we know that you know all things. You can see down the road, around the bend, things that we can't even see. And we thank you for protecting us and going forth with us, oh Heavenly Father, to protect us from those things that might hurt or harm us, oh Heavenly Father. For Lord, we can't do anything without you. We cannot walk. We cannot talk. We cannot stand on our own, but through you and with you, nothing is impossible. When sometimes we might feel alone,
But Heavenly Father, we know when you were on Calvary, you was alone. You had no one to comfort you. But we know if you endured the pain for all of us, oh Heavenly Father, there's nothing that we cannot do without you. We ask you right now that you bless the pastor this morning, oh Heavenly Father. For we know that you have given him a word from on high, and he will deliver that word to us. And we thank you for him and all that he does. We thank you for his wife, who is a support to him, and he supports this church family. And we thank you and bless that family, oh Heavenly Father. We bless all the families of God churches, oh Heavenly Father, wherever they might be. And we ask you to continue to bless as only you can. You have the power. You know it all. For who can love like you? In spite of our difficulties and things that we go through, life challenges. But we thank you, O Heavenly Father, for blessing us to face those challenges, whatever they might be, O Heavenly Father. We just can't thank you enough for all that you do. We pray right now in the name of Jesus, O Heavenly Father, that these services will be what you would have them to be this day, O Heavenly Father. And when we leave from this place, that we will be better than when we came in. For we know we are weak, but you are strong and powerful. And nothing in our lives happened by happenstance. It's all for a reason. Although we may not understand those reasons, but we trust you as a people, O Heavenly Father. We thank you, Lord, for all that you continue to do in our lives. And we ask you to continue to bless this services as we go forward this day, because we don't know what the future holds, but indeed we know who holds the future. And Lord, we do thank you for all that you do. We thank you again and ask all these thy blessings in your Son, holy, holy, and righteous name that he is. And let the church of God say amen, amen, and amen.
Heart is filled with despair. Remember, God cares
for you.
And when you're in doubt and you can't find your way out, He will see you through. Yes, He will.
See you through. See you through.
Just call.
Just call the name of Jesus.
Just call.
Just call His name.
when you're lonely and your heart is filled with despair. Remember God cares.
God cares for you.
And when you're in doubt and you can't find your way out, He will see you through. Yes, He will.
See you through. See you through.
Just call.
To say it again, Jesus, Jesus, oh how precious, oh how precious is the name, how precious, how precious is His name, for at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that He is Lord to the glory of God. Thank you, choir, for reminding us of, oh, how precious, precious is the name of Jesus. How precious is the name of Jesus. Worthy to be praised. Reverend Shelton, blessings, sir. All the officers and all of the leaders and the teachers and those of you who are aiding and helping with our young people. I didn't say that during my observation, but let me just give thanks to the Lord for you and what you are continuing to do in our classes, and those of you who saw fit to have your children come and be with church school this morning, let me commend you. Let me commend you. We know that in Christ the best is still yet to come, so we thank the Lord for those of you who see the need and realize that it is either now that we train them in the way that the Lord would have them to go, or they will lose that hope. So as we have this opportunity readily available to us, we want to do everything we can to make sure that we equip our young people, our young children, young boys and girls, for the future. So thank you so very, very much. And I said all visitors, but I noticed that Deaconess Blanding and Deacon Blanding have a bunch of their family here this morning. Amen. I just want them to stand. Amen. Amen. I missed it earlier. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm not going to call any names, but I want you to know how good it is to see you. And I wanted to call them out also because you see this family gathering. They were concerned about Deaconess Blanding and, you know, her health challenges. And you can see that she is surrounded by those who love her. And I would be remiss if I didn't say to you on her behalf, thank the Lord for you and for you just allowing her to know that you are there for her. And you know she's there for you, she and Deacon Blanding. That's a wonderful thing. A wonderful thing. Where there's unity, there's strength. And when families come together in such a way, I certainly want to give the Lord praise and thanks and encouragement to the family. So continue to do what you're doing. And we know that in Christ, the best is yet to come. I want to welcome Brother Don Lyon. I saw him on the choir joyfully singing with the choir this morning. Amen. We bless the Lord for him and for all that the Lord continues to do. You know, it's all in the Lord's hand. Yes, sir. And if we trust him, lean not to our own understanding, he will put things together that you nor I can put together. Amen. Because the ministry is his. The work is his. We are only pawns on his chessboard. That's all we are. And if we allow him to move us, and we are humble before him, and we say, as the choir said this morning, yes to his name and his will. And sometimes the yes is not really understanding, but learning how to walk by faith, not by sight. If the Lord said it, you don't have to worry. If he take you to it, he will take us through it. And all we have to do in our humanness is cast our cares upon him and walk by faith in the Spirit. Not in what we feel, and not in how sometimes we can fear, because those things can come upon us. But in the midst of that, the perfect love of Christ casts out all fear. Casts out all fear, and also make us to be able to embrace the fears and the uncertainty that we are having to be confronted with. So the Lord is good and greatly to be praise. God of our wearied years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far along the way, it is once again, Lord, we are privileged with this opportunity to stand in this place of worship and to just speak a word. And Father, I am nothing apart from you. I confess, Lord, my need for you. I confess my weaknesses and, Lord, my limitations apart from you. But I confess that through you, I can do all things that you commit and assign to my hand. So, Father, I cast my cares upon you. Everything I am and everything I am not, you are well aware. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, take these moments for your glory. Not for my glory, but for your glory, and let your will be done. Teach us thy statute and thy way. And Father, let the words of my mouth and let the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are our strength and our redeemer. Bless your people, the hearers thereof. For we ask it in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Order my steps. Order my steps. Mama. Amen. Order my steps. Order my steps in your word. For just a moment from the passage of scripture that was read in your hearing out of John chapter 5, verse 24, you find these words, "Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life." Has passed from death into life. Reclaiming the Lord's favor. Reclaiming the Lord's favor. Reclaiming the Lord's favor. Something that we lost way back in the garden when man sinned in disobedience toward God. It was a fall that took place. And ever since that fall, man has been in a struggle and trying to reclaim his state with the Lord. It is a hopeless drive on humanity's behalf. But it is something that the Lord graciously offer back to humanity. Not because we are worthy. Not because there is something so spectacular that we have done. Not because of our gifts and abilities that he has faithfully bestowed upon us, but because of his own grace and his own mercies, he has given us the opportunity to reclaim favor with him. It is not something that we can work for. It is not something that we can buy. It is not something that we can shout our way into, but it's only something that he can give. When individuals have disputes or have fallouts, whatever it may be that divide human beings, there has to be something that goes on in order to reconcile or reclaim what is lost. And sometimes it is not possible. Sometimes, because of just human nature and unforgiveness, it is hard to be able to reclaim those things. The Lord is merciful, and he loves us in spite of And because he has loved us and has given us his all, we are able to reclaim his favor, not just that he might give us food to eat or clothes to wear or roof over our head, but that he might restore us to a rightful position in him. And this verse allows us to understand that there is something that man has to do in order for that to happen. Not work, but it's an acceptance that has to be received. So the verse says, most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life. Not going to get it, but has it. And shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Past tense, has passed from death into life. Now the word reclaim is defined as having the ability to resume the possession of, or to take back, or to restore to a previous position. The word favor is defined as gaining approval, extended kindness, receiving grace, mercy, or unmerited acceptance, something that is undeserved, but yet you are able to receive it because of the love of the Lord. But he must be acknowledged. When an individual receives the Lord's favor and realizes his unworthiness to even stand before the Lord, it is truly a humbling and inexpressible experience. Every individual that has truly received the Lord and know that he is the author and the finisher of your faith will continue to try to express the joy that has brought you to that understanding, but it is inexpressible. You can rejoice in it. You can lift his name, but it's inexpressible. It continues to grow. It continues to develop, because what the Lord could not do, what you could not do, the Lord himself has done it on your behalf. This chapter 5 of John follows two previous encounters that Jesus had with two individuals in chapter 4. The woman of Samaria, which he met at the well in Sychar, and the nobleman who had a sick son in Capernaum. The Lord Jesus graciously extended his identity to the woman at the well and his healing power to the nobleman's son. He met the woman at the well who went there around midday, and he asked her for a drink of water. And after asking her for a drink of water and she recognizing who he was, she asked him a question. How is it that you ask of me a drink of water? But he said to her, woman, if you knew the gift of God and who it was that asks of you, you would have asked that he give you living water. The nobleman interceded for his son who had been sick. The Lord did not go with him as he had requested, but the Lord healed his son. And while he was on the way, a messenger came to him and remind him or inform him that his son had been healed. Here in chapter 5, verse 1 is a continuation of Jesus' mission from chapter 4. So it says it this way: after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. The Apostle John usually identified the specific feast in the travelogue of Jesus. However, this feast that is mentioned here in verse 1 is not specifically identified. But in verse 2, now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. And in these lay great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, and paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. Jesus healed the man at the pool of Bethesda. He took up his bed, and Jesus commanded him to walk. Had been there for 38 years, but the Lord told him to take up his bed and walk. The healing of the man at the pool of Bethesda ignited the beginning of open hostility toward Jesus, which increased in Jerusalem and the southern part of Palestine. The assumption of Scripture seemed to be that work was one's customary employment. But the rabbinical opinion expanded the law beyond the command of Old Testament restriction for the Sabbath day by implementing their own oral tradition that exasperate the original intent of the Old Testament command. So when the man was seen walking by the Jewish establishment and carrying his bed as he was commanded by the law, the Jews therefore said to the man who was cured that he was breaking the Sabbath command by carrying his bed on the Sabbath day. He answered them. He said, "Who made me well? He who made me well said to me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" Then they asked him, "Who is this man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk?'" For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him because he had done these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, "My Father has been working until now, and I have been working." Jesus further infuriated the Jews by claiming the Lord God as his Father. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son. He will show him greater works than these. For as the Father raises the dead and gives life to them, even so the Son gives life to whom he will. The Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son. All should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him." Now, in the previous statement, the Lord Jesus sets the standard for reclaiming the Lord's favor. It is only possible by accepting the Son who is the Lord's one and only gift offer. There's no other offer, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him should perish, should not perish, but have everlasting life. So verse 24 says it this way again, most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Now, this verse establishes the truth that the Lord Jesus gives life to whomever he desires. He gives a life. Those people are the one who hears the word. Those people are the one who believes the truth. Those people are the recipients of eternal life. They are the one that has passed from death unto life. Now we are waiting for the consummation of all things. But in Christ, we have already been reclaimed as believers in Christ. Those who have opened their heart to truly receive him, not with their head, but with their heart, the heart of their soul and mind. For we are commanded, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, with all thy soul, and with all thy strength. Notice it says nothing about the head. It says all about the very being of the individual, because the Lord wants the whole person, for he died for the whole person. Therefore, he wants to reclaim us, and he wants us to have favor with him. This lesson we see and recognize that Jesus is on his way. Here in chapter 5, we see him healing the man at the pool of Bethesda. And in chapter 6, we see him taking 2 little fish and 5 loaves of bread and feeding a multitude. In 7, he identifies himself as the living water. In 8, he identifies himself as the light of the world. So he is the one that is able to enable us to reclaim favor with the Lord. And there are 4 things that I want to say about Jesus here in this chapter that I want us to understand if we are going to reclaim the Lord's favor. The first is that the Son possesses redeeming power. I don't know where you've been, and I don't know who you may have been talking to, but if there's going to be redemption, it's going to come through the one that possesses redeeming power. That is not the preacher, that's not the Pope, that's not the religious establishment, that's not father nor mother, but it is the Son. The Son possesses redeeming power. That is power to bring us back, to reclaim the lost, and to bring them back into right favor with the Lord. For we have been separated because of sin. Those who are lost are separated because of sin. We have reclaimed favor because we have opened our hearts to receive what the Lord has offered through the Son. The Son possesses redeeming power. Listen to what it says. Most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, verse 25, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Those who are born again are already spiritually resurrected. They are already, they are not waiting. The spiritual resurrection and bodily resurrection are 2 different things. Spiritual resurrection means that our heart and our minds are now in tune with the Lord because we have heard his call of a reclamation, bringing us back to him through the Son who possesses redeeming power. Listen again. Most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Every man, apart from the redeeming power of the Lord Jesus, is walking around on death row. Walking around, dead man walking. It is the word of God, from God through Jesus Christ, that will redeem you back to a rightful state of favor with the Lord. Those who are born again are already spiritually resurrected. The believer has been made alive spiritually. Once were dead in trespasses and sin, but now, because of this redeeming power, has been made alive. And you, listen to the writer in Colossians, you being dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all your trespasses. Not when you get to heaven, but right now. Right now, we have been able, believers, to reclaim favor with the Lord. Not only that, in him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin, according to the riches of his grace, which he made abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. Not to gather us to be saved, but to gather those who are saved, both which are in heaven and which are on earth in him. In other words, the Lord Jesus possessed the redeeming power that enable us to reclaim favor with the Lord right now while we still live. And if you're here and you are out of the ark of safety, you don't know him in the pardon of your sin, I want to reiterate that the Son possesses redeeming power. And no matter where you may be, what you have done, he is still able to redeem you to a rightful state with the Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. He is able to bring you out of darkness and place you into the marvelous light. So it's the Son that will enable us to reclaim favor with the Lord. Secondly, the Son possesses resurrection power. Not only redeeming power, but resurrection power. Notice what verse 26 says. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. Jesus answered the religious establishment in John 2:19 and said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Why could he say that? Because the Son realized that he possessed resurrection power. He says in John 10:17, therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. The Son from all eternity had the right to grant life because he had resurrection power. Since he had resurrection power, possessed resurrection power, he has always had the right to grant life. John 1:4 reminds us in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And that light shined in darkness, and the darkness comprehend it not. Therefore, to reclaim a right favor with the Lord, we must understand that it's through the Son. And it is the Son that possesses redeeming power. It is the Son that possesses resurrection power. And if you are dead in your trespasses and sin, he can bring you out. For if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. He is made new through the power of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thirdly, the Son possessed ruling power. Ruling power and authority, ruling authority. And has given him, verse 27, authority to execute judgment. Also because he is the Son of Man. In Matthew 28:18, Jesus proclaimed to his disciples that all power had been given to him in heaven and in earth. You have given him authority over all flesh, that we should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. In John 17, before he ascended, before he was crucified, he could say, you have given that ruling authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. The Son had the power to rule with all authority. He has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. I was watching, Daniel said, in the night vision. And behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. Prophecy. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall never pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. Reclaiming favor, the Lord's favor will put us and those who are lost that will come to him in a position of understanding that the kingdom that we will enter will never be destroyed. Finally, the Son possesses righteousness and wisdom. This is what verse 28 says, as Jesus is still talking to this establishment that only see him as just another man. But yet, he's pressing his case before he goes to the cross, that he is the only way that a right favor can be reclaimed with the Lord. He says to them, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the grave will hear his voice. Don't marvel. Yes, I possess regeneration power. I possess the opportunity to resurrect you. I possess the opportunity to bring you into right favor. But do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the grave will hear his voice and come for those who have done good to the resurrection of a non-condemnation. I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is righteous because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. Now, possessing righteousness and wisdom is something that the world desires. But the world is limited in what it can offer. Righteous wisdom can only come from the righteous one. For you see, to have righteous wisdom, you must recognize truth from error. And we are living in a world now that call the lie the truth and call truth a lie. We must recognize truth from error. Well, the Lord will be able to recognize truth from error. Secondly, he will be able to root out deception from evil. We live in a world where folks will tell you one thing, but just as soon as you turn the corner, it can become something else. But the Lord knows the beginning from the end, so he can root out deception from evil. I know what I'm talking about, because if you go back and you look at Matthew, the Lord root out deception from evil after he had prayed for 40 days and 40 nights and came down out of the wilderness. Satan offered him bread. Why don't you turn these stones into bread? But our Lord, who is able to possess righteousness and wisdom, could root out the deception from evil. Satan did not want him just to eat bread. Satan wanted to control him. But because he was able to root out deception from evil, he could say to Satan, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Possessing righteousness and wisdom renders righteous judgment. You may not like it, but when you go down to the courthouse, the judge may rule in someone else's favor. That's unfair to you. But one thing about the righteous wisdom of God, if God says it's up, it's up. And if the Lord says it's right, it's right. And if the Lord says it's wrong, it is wrong. Jesus is proclaiming that the judgment he exercised will be dependent upon the will of his heavenly Father. So here he has the right to rule, and he has the right to resurrect. He has the authority to redeem and bring back to a state in Christ those who have done good by accepting, believing, and entrusting their life to Jesus Christ, the Son of God, will be reclaiming the Lord's favor. Can I say that again? Those who have done good by accepting, believing, and entrusting their life to Jesus Christ, the Son of God, will be reclaiming the work of God and be reclaiming the Lord's favor. The good is not the work of humanity, but the justification that comes from believing on the Lord's Son, embracing his finished work on Calvary, trusting in his resurrection out from the dead, and anticipating his second coming. If you've already believed on him and his finished work on Calvary and anticipating, wait on, he's coming back. Those who have done evil reject the Son's love, hate the light of God in Christ, and love the world rather than the Lord. And so they will not be able to reclaim the Lord's favor. The Son's position is witnessed by John the Baptizer, the finished work of Jesus, the Lord redeeming Lamb. The Lord God Father and Creator witnessed his work. The Holy Scriptures witnessed his work. And if you will open your heart to him, you can be reclaimed and you will have his favor. A favor come because he was virgin born. That's favor. He was holy and sinless. That's his favor. He was righteous and perfect. He was a substitute for our life. He was crucified and buried and rose on the third day. Well, the Lord was trying to remind them that if you want to be reclaimed, you got to believe what the Lord has laid down. You must possess the redeeming power that can only come through Jesus Christ. You must be resurrected by the power of God and God alone. You must possess the ruling one who is able to carry you through. And ye possess the righteous and the wisdom of God. Well, when I think of that and look at all that Jesus went through, he could either say to them, most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believe in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death on to life. Well, if Jesus is your Lord, you have already reclaimed favor with him. If Jesus is your Christ, you've already been redeemed from your lostness. If Jesus is your Christ, you are already resurrected spiritually, and you're just waiting for the final resurrection. If Jesus is your Christ, you got the right rule. It doesn't matter what the world may say or what the world may do. The Lord has the last word. The world can condemn you. The world can talk about you. The world can push you out. But Jesus has the right word. The Lord will stand the test of time. And when others talk about you, the Lord will be right there to let you know he has all wisdom and all power to bring you through. I'm so glad that when those who saw the man that got up from the pool and walked carrying his bed, and they asked him, who gave you power or permission to carry your bed on the Sabbath day? He could say, the one that told me to take up my bed and walk. Well, he stood the test. They challenged him, but he had the right one. I want to tell us that if you got the right one, stay with the Lord. If you stay with the Lord, he is our Redeemer. If you stay with the Lord, he is our Resurrector. If you stay with the Lord, he is the ruling one. If you stay with the Lord, he is the righteous judge. And no matter what the world says, he will judge rightly. And one of these old things, when it's all said and done, we will be back in his position. We will be back in the place of harmony and joy, reclaiming. The Lord's favor. Reclaiming his favor means that you have to see him with the one who possesses redeeming power. He's the one with resurrecting power. He's the one with ruling power. And he is the one with righteous and wisdom. The world does not possess that. He took it to the cross and he died on your behalf and on mine. And this verse he said before he went to the cross, most assuredly, I say to you, you and you, he who hears my word and and believe in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death unto life. Has passed from death unto life. You can't pass from death to life without being redeemed by the power of the Son. You can't have resurrection and eternal life without having the righteousness of Christ. You can't come to him with your own reconciliation, because he is the righteous ruler and he will rule rightly. And if you don't know him and you want to be reclaimed to the Lord, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Jesus is the recipient. He's the substitute for your sin, that you can reclaim the righteousness of God. And if you're here, you don't know him, I invite you to come. If you're here and you don't know him, you come. I write these things that you might know that you have eternal life. Reclaiming the Lord's favor. If you want to be in his favor, you come. If you don't know him, you come. Reclaiming his favor. He possesses redeeming power. He possessed resurrecting power. He possessed ruling power. He possessed all righteousness and wisdom. And he wants to offer you restoration before the Lord. Will you come? There may be one for prayer. I stretch my hand to thee. There's no other help I know. If you would withdraw your hand from me, I would have nowhere to go. There are many trying to reclaim favor with the Lord, but they're trying to do it some other way. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Remind us that I am the door. And reclaiming the Lord's favor by trying to climb up some other way, call you a thief and a robber. He wants to redeem you. He wants to resurrect you spiritually now. If he set you free, none other can incarcerate you. Will there be one for prayer this morning? For whatever the reason may be. Mm-hmm. God. All to Jesus. Father and our God, the creator of this vast universe, the giver of all good and perfect gift, the mediator between God and man, you who made a perfect sacrifice, that we who were on the outside would be reclaimed and brought back into right favor with you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and favor. Thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Thank you, Lord, for making us to realize and to understand that there was no hope of being reclaimed apart from your Son. There are many, Father, that have tried many things, have gone in different directions. But Lord, their souls are still not satisfied. Some have tried substance abuse. Some have traveled from one side of this globe to another. Some have gotten into situations that they regret, all searching, but not realizing, Lord, that the right favor with you can only come through your offer. And so, Lord, maybe there's someone who's come to this altar this morning, and they're designed to reclaim favor with you. I pray in your precious name that you will open their eyes to realize that there's nothing that they can do except open their heart to receive what you have offered. Believe on who you have offered and to place their trust in you. For you possess redemption. You possess resurrection to bring back to life. You are the righteous ruler. You have a ruling authority. And Lord, you are wise in your deliberations. Father, there is no other way. So bless now. Now, perhaps there are those who've come to this altar because they have physical issues. You are still a doctor that have never lost a case, a general that have never lost a battle. Just one touch, Lord, we know it's still a touch of healing. Perhaps there are those, Lord, who are going through financial straits. But Lord, the cattle on Thousand Hill is yours, Lord. All the gold in Fort Knox belong to you. You are still opening windows that we know not of. Bless, Father. Whatever the situation may be conflicts in families, Lord, I pray that you will expel that demon right now, that demon of pride, demon of selfishness, the demon of anger, a demon of unforgiveness. Whatever he may have tried to plant in your son, your daughter, I pray that you will remove it right now. We need you, Father. And we realize, Father, that we are no match for our enemy apart from you. But Lord, through you, there's nothing impossible for us to overcome. So whatever those needs may be this moment, we cast them all at your feet right now, asking you in the name of Jesus to lift your children up above their challenges, that they might see you and that they may be able to reclaim that right position where they can have the joy and peace on this side of eternity with the anticipation of the final resurrection that gives eternal peace apart from all of the challenges of this world. We love you, Father. We give you praise. Look on this branch of Zion. Keep us steadfast. Keep us immovable. Keep us abounding in your will and in your work for your glory and for the good of your children. Have your way. And when we too must leave, we pray then and thank you for preparing for us an eternal home where there's no more sickness, no more death, no more sorrow, no more challenges, but where we can live in that perfect estate once again. For we ask it all in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let us all say,
Amen.
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 Hopewell Baptist Church broadcast. We hope that you've been blessed by Pastor Addison's inspirational message. We cordially invite you to to join us for our semi-weekly Bible study on our Zoom platform every Tuesday and Wednesday, both at 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. Zoom meeting ID 316-292-5678. The meeting passcode is 075023. If you prefer to dial in, that number is 646-568-7788. For all contact information, ways for giving, and other church information, please visit our website at hopewellbaptistchurchsc.com. Thank you for your support and have a glorious and blessed week.